ouvinte, bem-vindo! É mais uma emissão telebombástica da Bomba na História! A menos de 24 horas de um novo confinamento. O pessoal andou na ramboia no período natalício e ano novo e o resultado está à vista. Apesar das escolas continuarem abertas, cá estamos nesta fábrica do conhecimento histórico, cultural e artístico, que é a Telebomba, porque não queremos que ninguém fique afastado do conhecimento de qualidade, de categoria, portanto. Hoje continuaremos a explanar, debruçar, desenvolver, esmiuçar esse tema que é a cultura do salão e daremos especial destaque à expansão do gosto neoclássico. Esperemos que seja do agrado do teleouvinte. Esperemos também que continue desse lado a acompanhar estas emissões que foram produzidas precisamente para si. E já sabe, Telebomba no ar. Bombemos juntos. No seu esforço para elaborar um fundamento para o neoclassicismo, alguns teóricos defenderam não só o regresso da arquitetura à sua essência, à sua origem primordial, como também a necessidade da arquitetura ser representativa e significante. Enquanto no primeiro caso temos a obra teórica de Marc-Antoine Laugier, a sugerir que a origem da arquitetura estava na cabana primitiva, sem dúvida na sequência da tese formulada por Rousseau sob o lema do regresso às origens, já no segundo caso foi Carlo Lodoli, um teórico italiano, a defender, para além de racional e funcional, a arquitetura devia exprimir o sentido do uso e da função a que se destinava. Ou não fosse este o espírito do iluminismo, segundo Diderot, para além de útil e bela, a arte devia contemplar um interesse moral, devia ser também instrutiva. Quem primeiro traduziu estes princípios em obra foi Jacques-Germain Soufflot, na Igreja de Santa Genoveva, em Paris, transformada em panteão após a Revolução Francesa. No traçado desta igreja, Soufflot desenvolve um exercício de fusão entre o panteão de Roma e a cúpula de São Pedro no Vaticano. O resultado é uma fachada resolvida num pórtico ao estilo dos templos romanos, coríntio, com gigantescas colunas e um entablamento contínuo e a aplicação de um sistema estrutural purista e rigoroso que dispensa todo o ornamento e todo o supérfluo. Ora, vejamos um pouco do exterior e do interior desta Igreja de Santa Genoveva.
You have made it to the magnificent Le Panthéon. The building was constructed after King Louis XV vowed that he would build a new grand basilica if he recovered from a great illness. During this time, he prayed to the patron saint of Paris, Saint Geneviève, that he would recover, and when he finally did in 1744, the new basilica was dedicated in her name. The area where the current Pantheon stands today has, however, been a sacred site for an even longer time. The place was a sacred site as early as 507 and later in 512, when it became the first burial place for the Saint Geneviève, who had protected Paris from the barbarians. The man responsible for the construction of the Pantheon was the Marquis de Marigny. and the foundation stone was laid in 1758. However, due to financial difficulties, the completion of the building was delayed until 1789. This was a time of revolution in France, and in 1791, the Constituent Assembly passed a decree that turned the Basilica into a temple to house the remains of the nation's greatest. Since then, the building has been converted back to a basilica twice. The converting back and forth did, however, stop with the burial of the famous writer Victor Hugo in 1885, and has ever since mainly served as a civic temple for France's greatest. The change from a basilica to a temple also led to some changes on the outside of the Pantheon. Above the front pillars at the main entrance, you will see the beautiful pediment which depicts the fatherland crowning the hero. You will also be able to read the inscription, Au grand homme la patrie reconnaissant, meaning, for the great men from the grateful homeland. If you look closely on the left side of the pediment, you will see two small men sitting down. These are the famous philosophers and writers Voltaire and Rousseau. This pediment is not the original one, but was added in 1837 to reflect the building's new use. Another typical feature you can see by looking at the main entrance is its Corinthian columns. The facade itself is modeled after the Pantheon of Agrippa in Rome. And both inside the Pantheon and on the outside, the Roman and Greek neoclassical features are evident. The Pantheon's large dome, found in the middle, was inspired by several similar Renaissance structures, and it was a smart way to lead daylight into the building, which was one of the architect Jacques-Germain Soufflot's main goals when designing the Pantheon. While the outside of the Pantheon is certainly impressive, most people visit for its inside. The inside is covered with the same Corinthian columns that you can see on the front facade. The inside also holds three other main features. The first one are the many beautiful drawings you'll see on the walls, each one telling a part of the French history, everything from the childhood of Saint Genevieve to the story of Jeanne d'Arc. In the middle of the Pantheon, you will find Foucault's pendulum. This is an invention by the physicist Léon Foucault, which demonstrates the rotation of the Earth. The invention was installed in 1851, but was later removed and reinstalled in 1995. Surrounding the invention, you will find early 20th century sculptures, including scenes from the French Revolution. The last main feature you will find on the inside is the magnificent statue in the far back. This is known as the National Convention, which shows the symbol of France, Marianne, surrounded by soldiers and members of the Parliament after the Revolution. Just underneath Marianne, you can read the phrase, Vivre libre.
Na igreja de Santa Genoveva, Soufflot desenvolveu uma planta em cruz grega, numa estrutura formada por colunas, entablamentos e frontões, em que todo o sentido ornamental e decorativo foi omitido. Pelo seu realismo estrutural, pela clareza formal e pela expressão purista, Santa Genoveva preconiza o início de uma nova arquitetura, o neoclassicismo, fundado numa expressão formal simples, pragmática e racional. A recorrência à linguagem clássica greco-romana como fonte inspiradora, ditou-lhe as regras: unidade, harmonia, proporção, simetria e sobriedade. A imagem que estamos a ver de fundo é o Templo da Glória, atual Igreja da Madeleine, projetado por Napoleão como um monumento às suas vitórias militares e como um repositório para os seus troféus. O Templo da Glória foi, após a sua morte, proposto para a principal estação ferroviária de Paris, até ser convertido em 1842 na Igreja de La Madeleine. Refletindo o interesse e a fidelidade à antiguidade clássica, o modelo para a sua concepção foi, sem dúvida, o Partenon, na Acrópole ateniense. Por outro lado, os artistas, os historiadores e os eruditos do século das luzes consideravam a antiguidade clássica uma referência sólida, estável e universalista, bem de acordo com os novos ideais e valores culturais que pretendiam difundir e implementar na nova sociedade. Pois a linguagem clássica é laica, materialista, pragmática e inspiradora de ideais de igualdade, liberdade e fraternidade conformes à Revolução. Um dos fenómenos indissociáveis do neoclassicismo foi a sua generalizada expansão por toda a Europa e respectivos espaços de influência, como os Estados Unidos da América, acabando por caracterizar como uma autêntica arte universal. A imagem que estamos a ver é o Capitólio de Washington, vinculando os ideais e os valores subjacentes à Revolução Americana e à democracia recentemente fundada. O Capitólio de Washington segue fielmente os conceitos neoclássicos e, principalmente, a inspiração na Igreja de Santa Genoveva de Soufflot, que serviu de referência para o desenho da cúpula. De seguida, apresentaremos um vídeo onde será possível ver o interior do Capitólio, assim como as obras de conservação do edifício que se realizaram há pouco mais de 4 anos.
No one thought this little experiment would endure. And now we've been the greatest nation in the world for so many years, and the symbol of that is the Capitol. It's timeless.
Every morning I go to the office. My office is just off the side of the rotunda. I always look up. It's an amazing thing to see. I'm just always in awe, and I just kind of pinch myself that this is a place I get to come to and work every day.
When you see that dome of the Capitol, it evokes a patriotic and emotional response.
It's America, and it's strong. It's alive. When I walk in, the heartbeat goes up.
It's something that every American citizen can benefit from.
The Dome of the Capitol is a symbol of freedom like no other in the world.
What it represents is the people's dreams of this country and everything that everybody has ever fought for.
It represents who we are as American people. It represents our oneness and our unity as a nation.
If you want to see a picture of the American democracy, take a look at the Capitol.
Charles Bullfinch built the first Capitol dome. Thomas E. Walter was the architect of the Capitol in 1850. He tripled the size of the building.
And suddenly the dome wasn't nearly big enough.
So Walter did a drawing of this incredible new dome sitting on top of the old building.
He actually hung up that drawing in his office.
And congressmen and senators would look at this magnificent drawing.
They quickly said, "We've got to do that." And lo and behold, they did.
They did look at the weight of the dome on the existing stone foundation. They also wanted some fire resistance. And they wanted it to last a long time.
It was pretty obvious that that meant cast iron. Civil War breaks out in 1861. The contractor, James Fowler Kirkland & Company, continues building the dome. They only had about 10 people working. They couldn't do much every day, but they worked every single day.
You just have such an appreciation for the people who actually built it to begin with.
The craftsmanship that goes into these ornaments that are made by hand.
For example, one column capital can comprise of over 200 pieces.
They're put together like a little puzzle where you put each piece together and then you put one final pin in that held it all together.
And they're all very well detailed. You know, they have the veins and the leaves showing.
They didn't have the same modern tools that we have. They certainly didn't have the conditions that we have. They were in the middle of a war, but they managed to do this, and it's absolutely amazing. The dome is over 150 years old. It's cast iron. It's going to deteriorate over time, as with any building material.
Over the years, rain, snow, ice took its toll.
There were several studies done assessing the dome, documenting the cracks, over 1,300 cracks.
Cracks that were several feet long in cast iron plates about 3/8 of an inch thick. We had a serious problem.
Not only of the face of the dome, but also the components that keep the dome together.
The entire structure was really threatened. It represented a safety concern.
Literally hundreds of pieces that have broken off and fallen to the roof of the Capitol building.
The last major restoration was back in 1959, 1960. They didn't go into as much detail as what we did.
The repairs that were done were virtually all welded, and many of those welds have re-cracked. We learned that the rain gutters were completely clogged with rust that was pouring off the dome from all of the pieces that have been rusting. Ultimately, the water got inside the dome.
I mean, look at what we could lose here, you know? A lot for a lot of people.
It's an enormous task. It is going to be a long time before we're able to do this again. So it's very, very important that when we do it right.
Before you even start on the job, there's a significant amount of planning. First, documenting the condition, estimates, schedules, plans.
We have this very fragile artwork and sensitive artwork sitting in the middle of our projects.
Pictures, paintings, you got everything in here. It's priceless.
So the first thing we did was install the safety netting in the rotunda of the dome.
The netting is what separates, allows us to work on this side safely and have the public on that side. So if a piece of cast iron were dropped, a tool, dust, any of that can't make it its way through.
A huge part of this job was the scaffold. And if you look at the unique way the scaffold was put together, both on the interior of the rotunda as well as the exterior, and that makes or breaks you for the entire project.
So we ended up with 25 levels of scaffolding. And if you laid them end to end, about 55 miles of scaffolding.
The lock and stitch saved this building. And it's stronger than the cast iron.
The lock and stitch method is a mechanical fastening of two pieces of cast iron.
Use the lock and stitch to seal a crack. So you fill it in with the steel instead of cast iron.
A series of pins are installed and the stitches are installed perpendicular and the head of the pin shears off at the right torque.
And grind it down, lock it, and it's done.
The balustrade around the tholos level of the dome was in such poor condition, the entire thing had to be shipped to the foundry. They were actually able to recycle and salvage a lot of the historical parts that were beyond repair. They melted the original parts down and reintroduced it into the balustrade that came back from the foundry. The cupola windows, the majority of them go back to the original construction of 1855. So we replaced five that were damaged beyond repair. So we replicated the same means and methods that they used to create the original windows. It's called slump pour glass. So they basically take a giant colander of 2,000 degree molten glass, they pour it between two rollers, and it rolls the entire window out. And it gets that wavy shower glass look pattern to it. Some of the worst damage of the dome is this internal gutter system that has failed. A number of new parts were made in the foundry. It was reassembled in their warehouse to make sure everything completely fit perfect and shipped back to the Capitol Dome, hoisted all the way up through 21 levels of scaffolding and reassembled the top of it.
In all of the dome, you have ornaments that we had to take out
that weigh up to 600 to 700 pounds. 36 giant acorn finials that sit above the windows. 36 giant acorn pendants that hang below the windows. 36 giant antifixes that sit on the rib lines. And there's 72 scrolls that go between them.
So all of that has to be disassembled, blasted, repaired, repainted, reassembled, and reattached.
There were certainly some that were damaged and rusted beyond repair.
And we would have to recreate those pieces.
We take one off that's in good shape, ship it off to the foundry, and they will 3D scan every single one of these parts in, and press it in a sand mold, and then pour molten cast iron in it to create the new part. Some of the larger items, like the gutters, those are up to 15 feet long. They can weigh up to 300-400 pounds. So those will make out of wood, plywood. They'll make a handmade pattern on that article. So the color on the exterior of the dome is a dome white color paint, specially made for the Capitol Dome, meant to replicate the sandstone painting of the west front of the Capitol from the original construction.
From what we discovered, the rotunda has always suffered from leaks from the roof. We had places where water had come through and rusted damaged plaster below, damaged cast iron here, rusted things, damaged coatings.
The paint bubbles, it pops away from the underlying layers. This is a disaster.
Basically, the amount of deterioration on the exterior had been mirrored on the interior, and so this was the moment to fix the interior as well. Starting from the top, we're doing a lot of cast iron repairs and painting. We worked our way down to the frieze. We're repairing areas that have been damaged.
As part of this work, all of the lead paint is being removed, down to the bare cast iron.
The interior had never been stripped down before. So all the original coats of paint were on there. And that in and of itself was a treasure, being able to go back and look at the many layers of history.
Hundreds and hundreds of samples were removed from the cast iron.
We were able to develop timelines of what the different color schemes were.
What we found was the interior rotunda has been painted 4 times. What we're doing now is the 5th. When we were talking about how do we paint the interior of the rotunda, you know, the first thought was, well, let's look at the historic color schemes and choose one of those.
And we painted 2 coffers, a palette from 1906 and a palette from 1866. The 1906 palette was much more pleasing, so we started with that, and then we revised value to give it more contrast.
Pierre L'Enfant said to George Washington, "Place this Capitol building upon a pedestal awaiting a monument." And it's still a monument today.
This restoration will be part of the history of this magnificent building.
This goes so far beyond craftsmanship. This is symbolic.
It is truly a symbol of what it's taken to get to the point that we are at today. You know, the Statue of Freedom isn't just icing on the cake. It means something.
What we're trying to preserve here is the solidness of our country.
It's just an amazing responsibility that we have on our shoulders to preserve the principles of our founding, to preserve the American idea, and therefore preserve the building and the rotunda.
To hand them down to the next generation. I mean, it's our responsibility. We're just stewards of these irreplaceable treasures. We've got to take care of them.
This represents the United States. Everybody, entire world, is looking at this building.
Brings about a sense of patriotism, a sense of strength, a sense of unity.
What other symbol can you think of that stands more for freedom? It stands for freedom.
Nos anos de 1750 e 1760, um conjunto de livros, tratados, desenhos, gravuras e pinturas, divulgando o formulário do classicismo, espalharam-se por França, Alemanha, Inglaterra e Itália, chegando mais tarde aos Estados Unidos. Aqui foi importante o papel de Thomas Jefferson, o terceiro presidente dos Estados Unidos, que, enquanto embaixador americano em Versalhes, contactou com a cultura clássica e assimilou o paladianismo inglês. Numa irrepreensível criação da Vila Rotonda de Palladio, desenhou a sua própria casa em Monticello, Virgínia.
Jefferson lived here at Monticello. To him, it was more than just a home, and according to some historians, it serves as a kind of architectural autobiography. The name Monticello means little mountain in Italian, a fitting description of the location where the self-taught architect chose to build his home. Construction on the 43-room mansion began in 1770. Shortly after Jefferson was first elected to public office. It went through many designs and redesigns and wasn't finished until 1809, the last year of his presidency. Jefferson was influenced by the designs of the late Italian architect Palladio, and his travels to France inspired him to add skylights and the famous dome room. Jefferson, who valued his privacy, left the house surrounded by trees. He did clear enough space for several gardens, where the avid horticulturist grew more than 250 kinds of vegetables and herbs. Jefferson once said, "I am as happy nowhere else and in no other society, and all my wishes end, or I hope my days will end, at Monticello." His days did end here on July 4th, 1826, exactly 50 years after American independence. Jefferson left instructions that his gravestone should be an obelisk, and he also wrote his own epitaph. "Here was buried Thomas Jefferson, author of the Declaration of American Independence, of the Statute of Virginia for Religious Freedom, and father of the University of Virginia." Jefferson, who didn't even mention being the country's third president, clearly didn't want his work at UVA to be forgotten. Jefferson had his hand in every element of the school's creation. He designed the buildings, chose books for the library, and helped shape the curriculum. The retired statesman even hosted a weekly dinner for students, including a young writer named Edgar Allan Poe.
Na Alemanha, distinguimos Carl Schinkel com uma obra de inspiração grega corretamente clássica, o Altes Museum, o Museu da Arte Antiga de Berlim. Ao mesmo tempo, em Inglaterra, destacamos a importância de John Nash. Nash foi um dos arquitetos que aderiu ao neoclassicismo de forma mais ampla. nos seus projetos e recursos ao vocabulário clássico, não constituiu um fim, mas sim um meio de exprimir o seu espírito inventivo. Ficaram célebres os seus terraces e places em torno de Regent Park e Regent Street, em Londres, salientando corpos, quebrando a continuidade a extensas fachadas, com curvas e articulações diversas, numa dinâmica que fez evoluir o neoclassicismo para outros percursos. É um facto que a Roma antiga atraía, sobretudo pelas suas virtudes republicanas, pela abnegação dos seus cidadãos à causa nacional e pelo heroísmo daqueles que edificaram o poder e a glória da cidade eterna. Por outro lado, Roma evocava o pragmatismo, a eficácia das suas instituições, e um Estado de Direito fundado em princípios racionais e em valores universais. Daí que, embora afirmassem claramente os objetivos do programa neoclássico, as teorias de Loguière e Lodoli proporcionaram a sua evolução para formas geométricas cada vez mais puras e despojadas de qualquer índice decorativo, mas de forte evocação simbólica. Sem retórica nem ornamento, as ordens clássicas impuseram-se à forma e adaptaram-se às mais diversas tipologias e programas de arquitetura: museus, tribunais, assembleias nacionais, bancos, galerias comerciais, fábricas, gares ferroviárias, entre muitos outros. Daqui decorre que, mais do que uma imitação do antigo, o neoclassicismo se definiu como um regresso ao passado, assente numa reflexão aprofundada e rigorosa da antiguidade greco-romana. Alguns desses arquétipos, templos, arcos de triunfo, pórticos, frontões ou colunas comemorativas, são agora interpretados em formas monumentais, puristas e geométricas. Por exemplo, na Igreja de Madeleine, em Paris, que estamos a ver, o modelo e a fachada tradicional do templo grego foram retomados de tal modo que o espaçamento regular das colunas, a perfeita horizontalidade, verticalidade dos elementos e a monumentalidade do edifício acentuam a grandiloquência do empreendimento e glorificam a sociedade que o ergueu. O radicalismo de algumas propostas e a problemática viabilidade de alguns projetos levou a integrar uma geração de arquitetos visionários numa vertente utópica, com uma forte carga ideológica pronunciadora do romantismo. Incluem-se nesta tendência arquitetos como Jean-Jacques Le Clos, Étienne-Louis Boulay e Claude Ludot, cujas obras, na sua maioria, não passaram do projeto. Jean-Jacques Ludot apresentou uma arquitetura de sabor maneirista, mas de referências ecléticas e anunciando o revivalismo oitocentista. Quanto a Étienne-Louis Boulay, este deixou-nos uma obra desconcertante como este cenotáfio a Newton. Boulay criou uma gigantesca esfera, incorporando um planetário num desenho expressivo e visionário carregado de sentido e de simbolismo. Este era um monumento funerário de dimensões gigantescas. A esfera tinha 150 metros de diâmetro, inspirado no Panteão de Roma. No interior, havia uma enorme câmara esférica com um grande sarcófago na base que devia receber os restos mortais do eminente filósofo e cientista. Mesmo considerando os avanços da tecnologia construtiva da época, não é difícil perceber que projetos com esta complexidade técnica não podiam ser construídos. A sua obra evoca uma arquitetura de verdade, ou como foi designada, uma architecture parlante, ou seja, uma arquitetura falante que transmite diretamente e sem equívocos a sua função ao observador. Boulez deixou-nos os primeiros modelos daquilo que podemos considerar a primeira arquitetura racionalista. Menos radical do que Boulez, mas igualmente visionário, Ledoux, que viu alguns dos seus projetos serem concretizados. Publicados no livro L'Architecture Considérée, em 1804, de entre eles destacamos aquele que é, porventura, o seu trabalho mais ambicioso, as Salinas Reais de Chaux. Trata-se de uma cidade ideal projetada para um estabelecimento industrial que, antecipando o debate sobre o urbanismo moderno, se vincula com grande antecedência ao pensamento do socialismo utópico, patente no urbanismo da primeira metade do século XIX. E foi assim, caro teleouvinte, mais uma emissão da Telebomba. Com a arquitetura visionária, terminamos assim esta emissão. Próxima emissão, falaremos de pintura e escultura. Fique desse lado, continue a acompanhar-nos nos canais do costume. E não esqueça, hashtag Eu Aprendi com a Bomba. Até à próxima emissão, carta do ouvinte. Fique em segurança, cuide-se, use a máscara, distanciamento social e tenha juízo. Telebomba no ar, bombemos juntos.